join the presiding elder, Ronald Robin, in welcoming each and every one of you in a very special way for our session this morning. We've been planning for this for the past 3 months. I happened to meet Dr. Tamatayo about 1.5 years ago in AUP, and I heard that he has built a visionary church, envisioning how he would like to fill this church in the near future with people. So the Holy Spirit laid on my heart that we have to have a particular day of meeting, that we would fast and pray. How true and how great a God we serve, that He has made it possible for us to see the reality and the actualization of the dream. Amen. I would like to welcome each and every one of you. Without wasting much time, let us listen to what the Spirit of God has to say to each and every one of us. Let us ask the Holy Spirit to speak to us. Father, Your word is inspired, and Your Holy Spirit can always effect a change. This morning, maybe there are some seated here mistakenly, because they just wanted to go to a Saturday service, finish the formality, and go back. Speak to us, Lord. We are not here to be intellectually informed. We are here to be regenerated, to have a regenesis. Genesis means beginning. Regenesis means re-beginning, new beginning. May every one of us have a new beginning, beginning from today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If I were to ask you a question, who is the desire of your eyes? What would be your answer? Maybe I would like to ask just two of you to give me an answer. Who is the desire of your eyes? I will ask my most beloved doctor, Dr. Marina. Who is the desire of your eyes? I'm happy he's pointing to his wife. I want to ask my beloved mother, Mrs. Carora. Who is the desire of your eyes? I like that. She's pointing to someone heavenward. Open your Bibles, please, and come with me as we are going to study about the desire of your eyes, that you will have a re-beginning. Let me ask you a question, after which I will get right into the message of this great man. Can you think of someone in the Bible who is not only a prophet, who is also a priest? Beg your pardon? I didn't hear. Melchizedek, okay. Someone who is a prophet and a priest simultaneously. Very close, you're getting very close. No, anyone who tells the right answer will get 1,000 pesos from Dr. Sebrian, not from me, okay? So, one more chance. I appreciate all your wrong answers. Appreciate. Ezekiel. Ezekiel was a priest and Ezekiel was a prophet. Let me give you a brief background about Ezekiel. Ezekiel was carried as a slave, as a captive, all the way from Jerusalem right into Babylon. And what was his ministry? His ministry was exclusively to the Jews who had been carried as captives. Ezekiel was a highly respected priest and a prophet. And the only job that God had given Ezekiel was to declare the hour of the judgment. Probably Ezekiel was a wonderful priest under prophet all the way in Jerusalem, but to be carried back all the way to a foreign country and to be treated like a slave, I'm not sure what kind of a heavy heart and a burden he would have had. As soon as he reached there, God gave him a message. Let's open our Bibles. Everybody, please come with me to Ezekiel chapter 24 and verse 15. Also, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, behold, I take away from thee the desire of your eyes with a stroke. This is God speaking to Ezekiel. What is God speaking to Ezekiel? Son of man. Let's stop here. The word son of man is a very interesting phrase. Son of man usually refers to Jesus Christ. Jesus is a priest. Jesus is a prophet. So this is just an allegorical language, a symbol that is figurative, highly symbolic, symbolizing, signifying the fact that God wanted to tell through Ezekiel that you are a son of man. I have another son of man who is none other than Jesus. Ezekiel, I have a message for you. Lord, tell. I will take away from you the desire of your eyes with a stroke. If you want to know what stroke is, it is not physically referring to the stroke that we all get once in a while. It is talking about a sudden illness falling on you in the Hebrew, and God is telling, I'm going to take the desire of your eyes. In other words, who is the desire of Ezekiel's eye? His wife. Ezekiel, I'm going to take away your wife. Your wife will die. The time has come for you to lose your wife. You have to know, my friends, what it is to be a pastor's wife. I'm not sure how many of you are pastor's wife. Can I see your hand? I see only one hand. It is very difficult to be a pastor's wife. Am I telling the truth? Extremely challenging. Those of you girls who are premeditating to marry a pastor, you are doing the greatest evangelism to an evangelist. Amen? You may not understand what it is. The Bible is clear. Ezekiel's wife was so close. Every time he came home after the church board and everybody had knocked him down, he knows there's only one woman waiting for me. And every time he comes hungry, there's one woman who loves and gives him calamansi or gives him a wonderful vegetarian garden special pizza, or someone who's saying, I love you, my honey, but now God tells him, I will take your wife from you. Your wife will die. She's your desire. Men, I hope your wife is the only desire of your eye. Don't you ever dare to look at somebody else or someone who is not your wife, because the desire of your eyes must be your husband, must be your wife. Amen. That's what God means to each of us. And he says, I will take your wife in a short while. When people are talking about this, they don't understand, Lord, what kind of a message are you talking about this, Lord? Let's see what Bible says God was going to take away Ezekiel's wife. Let me just go to the other one. But Ezekiel, when your wife dies, you're going to do something. Lord, please tell me. Look at this. You will not mourn. You will not weep. And tears should not run down your eyes. Men, if your wife dies, if the pastor comes and tells, sir, you should not mourn, you should not weep, you should not have tears down, will you be appreciative of what I say? Yes or no? Definitely not. Look at what God says. He says, you will not mourn. What does that mean? Number one, when you're going to be regenerated, when you're going to be renewed, when you're going to be revived, you're just commanded to do something even when your companions are gone. You just have to do what you're supposed to do. What is the real lesson? Let's continue the story. And so it happens, Ezekiel took his Bible and he went. He's now not in Jerusalem, but he's now in Babylon. He's one of the captives among the other captives, but God makes him a prophet and he gives him a beautiful message. You need to understand, every prophet God chooses is a unique personality, and not only the sermon that he preaches, but he himself is a sign, a message. For instance, God told Hosea, go and marry a prostitute. Why? The children of Israel were prostituting with other gods. So you or me, that is, you will represent the Yahweh God, and these all will be represented by Gomer. Okay, Lord. Here is God giving a message to Ezekiel. Inasmuch as I love my people, I know you also love your wife, but I want you to go and preach. This morning, you will preach a message to all my people. Okay, Lord. What will happen after I preach? Exactly after you preach, when you come home, you will find your wife dead in the bed. Can you imagine that we as husbands, your wife comes to the door and she says, hi, have a nice day. I will fix a good dinner for you. And she sends you with a loving kiss and a bye. She sees you off and you are off to the duty. You come back. You ring the calling bell, nobody opens, and after some time, you break the window open, you go inside to find that your wife is dead. Ezekiel, I will take away the desire of your eyes. God says 6 instructions. Let's read one by one. Forbear to cry. In the Middle East culture, in the Bible times, in Palestine, where much of the biblical event and story took place, every time someone dies, there are supposed to be 6 things that will be jotted down. 6 things. Number one, you have to cry. And people also hired people to cry. Can you believe that? They have no idea how you are related to the deceased. They go and say, sir, we give you 3,000 pesos. Okay, sir. You have to cry for 3 hours. No problem. They come into the house. They have no idea whether it is a man or a woman, young or old. They said, start. There is a group, soprano, bass, alto, second tenor. They all join together and they start crying. But Ezekiel is told specifically, do not cry. You have to know something, my friends. There is a difference between sorrow and mourning. Did you know that? Yes or no? You don't know the difference between sorrow and mourning? Before marriage, if you don't see your girlfriend, you have sorrow. But after marriage, if you see your wife, you have mourning. No, that's not the real difference. Let's see. Make no mourning for the dead. In other words, mourning means you not only cry, you are so engrossed in your grief, you're deeply distressed, but God tells you cannot cry. You cannot mourn for the dead. Look at the next one. Bind the tear of thine head upon thee. As soon as someone who is close to you is dead, you are supposed to shave your head. And then, you cannot have anything on your head. But God tells Ezekiel, you have to put a tear. You know what is a tear? I wish you can know that. It is called a turban. Do you know who wears a turban? Turbans are worn only during celebrations. Ezekiel, when your wife dies, no crying, no deeply mourning. You cannot hire any mourners, no crying people. Number three, you have to wear and you have to show people that you're not grieved, but you're celebrating. Look at the next one. As soon as someone's spouse is dead, you need to immediately remove the sandal. But God says, no, you will wear the shoes. Well, I can't imagine what God is saying. If you read 2 Samuel 15:30, you read the concept of covering your head. In Isaiah 22, you see you have to walk with bare feet. Let's go to the next one. Cover not thy lips. If you read Leviticus 13:45, the moment someone cries, so someone is dead, you have to cover your upper lip. To the extent you have to weep and weep. But when you weep, you have to cover, you have to remove, you cannot have anything to eat. Let's see what the Bible says. Eat not the bread of men. As soon as somebody's wife or husband is dead, the neighbors immediately make a special bread. And this bread is eaten only by those people who have lost their loved ones. But Ezekiel, I'm going to tell you, when your desire of your eyes, your wife is dead, you cannot do anything. In other words, what God is telling is, even if you want to cry, you cannot cry in public. Nobody in the public can see. I've been a pastor all my life. One of the hardest things for me to do, I don't take one appointment at all, and that is to preach during funeral, because I'm a very emotional guy. I cannot see anyone. If I see someone cry, in 1 second I will cry. So I take up any appointment except for preaching. So in case anything happens in your family, don't call me for that event. The Bible is clear. What is the Bible talking about? Lord, please teach us, what does this mean? When he loses his wife, he cannot mourn, he cannot cry, he has to bind the tear, he has to put on the shoe, he cannot cover the lips, he cannot eat the bread of the morning. Tell us, Lord. You need to understand, my friends, Ezekiel's entire life was a testimony to the exiles. Likewise, you have to know who is the Ezekiel today. Ezekiel is God. Who is Ezekiel's wife? Tell me, church. Tell me, who is Ezekiel's wife? Who? You. Likewise, this should be the case with all the children of God. You shall not mourn or weep. This is a unique action which is given in the whole Bible only to Ezekiel. Do you know, if you read the Bible, God tells you have to mourn. You have to cry. You have to weep. You have to do all these things, but only to Ezekiel. Lord, please teach us why. Let's go to the Bible and see, why did God really tell? I'm going to show you the pattern of mourning even with birds and animals. If a bird or an animal happens to lose its spouse, I want you to know, a camel lost its spouse. You see the way it's mourning. Look at the gorilla right on the left. It's mourning. Look at the bird. I'm going to show you another one that was very touching. There is an ape that was dead, and all the apes mourned literally. What you're seeing is a real picture. What about human beings? Human beings. This is a certain tribe. Every time someone dies in this tribe, the first thing they are supposed to do is they are supposed to shave the head, and all over the body they are supposed to put charcoal. Let's look at Ezekiel's life. Ezekiel was a preacher. Ezekiel was a prophet. Ezekiel was a priest. But when his wife died, God said nothing. I want you to look at this. Here is a pastor. Here is an evangelist. Here is a priest. Let's look at the Bible. I spake unto the people in the morning, and that even my wife died. Can you believe, my friends? He went to the church. He finished the divine service. By the time he was going back, he saw his wife dead. I preached in the morning, and my evening, my wife dies. And after the wife was gone, after the desire of his eyes was gone, what did he do? I did as I was commanded. Let us just read what the Bible really has to talk about this. Ezekiel's wife was everything to Ezekiel. God was first in Ezekiel's life and then his wife. She was the strength, she was the joy, she was the glory, she was the desire, and she was the only one where he put his whole heart, mind, and soul. Every thought was about his wife. Even when he was thinking of God, he was thinking of his beloved wife. Ezekiel, you have lost a powerful tool in your ministry. Ezekiel, you will never hear her sing. Ezekiel, there is no one to fix your supper. Ezekiel, you have no moral strength. Ezekiel, you have no sexual partner. Ezekiel, there is nobody to rub your forehead every time you complain of headache. Ezekiel, there is no one to walk by and hold your arms for the evening and morning walk. Ezekiel, God chose Ezekiel, and God permitted Ezekiel's wife to die to teach about you and me. Open your Bibles, please. Open your Bibles this morning. Come with me to Ezekiel 24 as we get into a very deeper message to find out how God wants to regenerate, renew, revive the children of Israel. Open your Bibles, please. Come with me to Ezekiel 24. God took her in order to prove a point to Jerusalem, and he also told Ezekiel not to mourn. No longer will he have. What is the reason? Let's go to the Bible and find out. Come with me to Ezekiel 24 and verse 19. This is the paradox of God's people. And the people said unto me, wilt thou tell us what these things ought to, will thou not tell us what these things ought to us that thou doest so? Can you believe this? Every time a prophet came to Jerusalem and he preached the gospel, he preached his heart out. God is coming. Jesus is coming. Every time a prophet came, they killed the prophets. Every time God raised a priest, they killed the priest. Every time God raised someone to the prophetic office, the people of God turned a deaf ear. And every time someone came preaching the good news of the first coming of Jesus, there was not even a single man who repented. But now, when Ezekiel is not preaching, people want to hear a message. How paradoxical. If you are in the hearing of my voice this Sabbath morning, there is coming a time when you will hear no more preaching. You will hear no more prophet. Very soon, it's coming in Jesus' name. You will have no meeting, no churches. You will look for preachers. Nobody will preach to you. When someone preaches, let's listen. What is the meaning? In other words, they are now telling, your wife is dead. Your wife is gone. But you're supposed to mourn. You're not doing anything. Ezekiel, tell us the significance. Because everybody knows that a prophet's life is a message more than he preaching the message. Let's go to the Bible now. I hope you have your Bibles. Please have a just bird's eye view of verses 15, 16, 17, and 18. Let me just give you the background. We do not have the time to study the entire message, but here is the gist. This is precisely a bird's eye view. What is this? Obedience. When the desire of your wife, of your eye is gone, it is an object lesson to the children of Israel the Lord commanded. What is that? He can groan only to himself. If you have any personal sorrow, I'm sorry, you cannot do it publicly. In other words, you have to obey me. Okay, Lord? Friends, I want to ask you a question. Do you know what is the message? What is the meat of the message? There is only one grief in this world which is more excruciating than losing your wife. And after losing your wife, you are told, don't grieve. Can you tell me something? Is there anything much more painful than grieving for your spouse? Yes or no? Yes. What is that? What is more excruciatingly painful than losing your wife? I know losing your wife is excruciatingly painful, but there is something even more painful than losing your wife. Losing your eternal life. This morning, we are going to get a little more deeper. The only grief more excruciating than losing your spouse and not being allowed to grieve would be to lose eternal life simply because you and I have not repented. We have not been made new. This morning, you don't have to die. God wants to give you a new beginning, and He wants to give you eternal life. Don't lose eternal life. Amen? Let's go to the Bible. And the word of the Lord is coming again to him. I want you to know this. I love to read the Bible because the Bible is amazing. Here comes Ezekiel. He's taken all the way from Jerusalem, taken all the way to Babylon. Here he's a priest. Here he's a prophet. Every now and then the word of the Lord comes. And when he speaks, there is creation. The word of God has the power to create and to recreate and to regenerate, to revive, to renew, to transform, to build you. That's the power of the word of God. Amen? Do you want to be made new? Made new. Made new this morning by the power of God's word. I want you to know, listen to the word of God. The word of God came to Ezekiel. Where is Ezekiel? Please tell me now. At this point, when his wife dies, where is Ezekiel? Geographically, Babylon. But where is the temple of Jerusalem? Where is the temple of Jerusalem? Is this a tough question? The temple of Jerusalem is in... Intelligent people appreciate that. Is in Jerusalem. But I want you to see what happened. When his wife died shortly, Ezekiel obeyed the Lord's instruction. Ezekiel obeyed fully. In both these cases, you should know, God revealed to him, hey, listen to the word of God. Please tell us, you and I have been carried captives here a few years ago, but God is going to destroy the temple back home in our country. So please repent. Why would God want to destroy the temple in Jerusalem? And what has that got to do with Ezekiel? And what has the destruction of the temple of Jerusalem got to do with the death of Ezekiel's wife? Is there a link? People of God, let's look at the Bible. Let's look at the Bible. Wow, I like this. Speak unto the house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord God, the excellency of your strength, the desire of your eyes, and that which your soul pitieth. Wow. I will profane something which is the excellency of your strength and the desire of your eyes. Who was Ezekiel's desire of his eyes? His wife. But what was the desire of the eyes of the children of Israel? What was the desire? Thank you, Dr. Cyprian. The temple. I want you to look here. That Ezekiel's wife represents something very peculiar.
Inasmuch your wife has been the desire of your eyes, my people desire is not me. Is not me. I want to share something with you. As a married man, my wife always tells me, I will always give you permission to go anywhere, preach anywhere, do anything. But any woman who is less than 40 years, you should not speak for more than 4 minutes. So every 4 minutes, I take a break and renew again. You know, you also have to be very obedient to your wife, you see. Why? She always tells, don't let any woman take you, man. I said, okay. The Bible is very clear here. Inasmuch as a spouse's desire of his or her eyes is another spouse, God's people did not have God as the desire of their eyes. They had the temple. This morning I want to ask a question to myself as you ask a question to yourself. What is the desire of your eye? What is the desire of your heart? Heart of heart, be honest. Do you love another woman or another man more than you love the Lord? Do you love someone else, a job, money, status quo, power, position? What is the desire of your eye? The children of Israel's desire was the temple. Let's look at this. Let's just go there. The desire of your eyes. The excellency of the strength of God's people was not God. It was not the God of the temple. It was the temple of God. Now I'm going to give you two reasons, primarily, about why God chose Ezekiel's wife to be a sign. How many of you knew that Ezekiel's wife died before you listened to this sermon? How many of you knew? Not really? You're going to be blessed. It's very, actually, I can preach this sermon for 3 hours. 3 hours, and every bit of the love story between Ezekiel and wife is so heartwarming. It will bring tears to your eyes. But we will not preach for 3 hours. Let me try my best to be as brief as possible. I promised you I will finish at 12:30, but I don't think I will keep my promise. I will try. Let's go to the Bible. Ezekiel's wife was a sign. Ezekiel's wife represents you and me, the spiritual children of Israel. Ezekiel's wife represents the temple. Ezekiel's wife represents Jerusalem. The children of Israel's desire was the temple, was Jerusalem. They couldn't take Jerusalem by force. The temple, who built the temple in Jerusalem? Come on, quickly. Solomon. Do you know, friends, that was the most amazing architect you could ever see. He is a man of amazing architect. He built such a wonderful temple. Of course, we are not supposed to call it as Solomon's temple. There is nothing called Solomon's temple. It is the temple of the Lord, but architect was Solomon. So next time you tell somebody, oh, Solomon's temple, actually biblically, you're wrong. This is the temple of the Lord. So you have to understand now, the temple of the Lord built by Solomon was of great renown. You know why? It had marbles. It had precious jewels. It had the grandeur. It had the glory. It had the splendor. It was a city. And it was the city that housed the temple. People from across came to see the temple. And everybody's eyes was fixed only on the temple of God and not on the God of the temple. You know why? That was the excellency of their strength. That was the desire of their eyes. God says, I will destroy the desire of God's people. Now, the news is going to come. Before God could send Nebuchadnezzar, Babylonians and his army all the way to Jerusalem and to destroy the walls and to burn the gates, before God could use these military forces all the way from a foreign country and bring it to nothing, God revealed it in Babylon to
to prophet. How can a prophet in Babylon know that God was going to send Nebuchadnezzar and Babylonian army and destroy the desire of fire? It needs the Spirit of God. Can I tell what is going to happen in the U.S. 3 months from now, staying in the Philippines? Impossible. But if I happen to reveal something, surely it should be supernatural. So here, Ezekiel receives a vision in Babylon. Did it happen? Definitely. So when God destroyed the temple, He allowed a foreign nation to come. He allowed a foreign king to come. What did he do? He did not come all of a sudden, march inside and destroy the city. First, he besieged. Is there anyone here who can tell me how many years did Nebuchadnezzar besiege the city before he could go and destroy the city? How many years? How many years? It took him less than 3 years to besiege. You know what is besiege? Just go around and capture. No going out, no coming in. For example, if Manila is besieged, no vegetables coming, nothing going out, what will you have? Fasting and prayer meeting every day. That is why we need to fast when it is not besieged. There is coming a time where Manila is going to be besieged. And I tell you in the name of Jesus, it may not be physically. Many of us, I hope you're all taking aware of what's happening during September. Are you aware of the current financial crisis? There is coming a time in one day you will lose all your money, your account. That account that you have as the desire of your eyes will be frozen. You will have the ATM card, but no money will come out. What is the desire? Let's go here and try to prove something. Besieging is more dangerous than capturing. Has the devil besieged any of your life? That there is no inflow of the Holy Spirit inside your life, and there is no outflow of prayer. If you have no prayer inside to outside, and if there is no flowing of the Holy Spirit from outside to inside, the devil has besieged. Once the devil besieged, there will be famine in your soul. And when there is famine, the devil destroys you. That's how. Do you know why was Nebuchadnezzar so angry? Why did he destroy the temple? They did not allow these guys to come inside. So he was so angry. 3 years he has been working to deal. So when he came inside, he came with so much of wrath and anger and fury. He just brought the walls down. He just broke the gates and he burnt it. He destroyed the temple. He burnt the temple. He carried all the silver and gold. The devil's only intention is to destroy your soul temple. Now that takes us to another level. Do you grieve when Jerusalem is destroyed? Don't grieve this morning for Jerusalem, for temple. Grieve for your sins. Grieve for your abominations. Don't grieve for the throne. Think of the many mothers who will not have sons simply because of the children of Israel. Nebuchadnezzar came and killed them. The city that once used to be called the temple city is now defamed. You know, friends, that takes us to the next level. What is that? Even when your cheer is gone, continue to do what God had been doing to you. Now, I want to show a Hebrew parallelism. Look at these two verses. The desire of your eyes. That is verse 16. And look at verse 21. The desire of your eyes. When you read the Bible, you should always look for something in the beginning. And when you read the passage, you look for something at the end. We call it as the chiastic structure. What you find here, you find there. A, B, B, and right in the middle will always be the focal point, the center point. That's where the fulcrum really lies. What is happening here? Ezekiel is now explaining that his wife's death signifies God's temple will be destroyed, like the desire of my eye. My eyes were my wife, but your eyes were your temple. God will take it. Not only that, he will also slaughter the people. And Ezekiel lost. Ezekiel had experienced a personal tragedy. And so also all those reasons. Now let's go to the second reason. Was Ezekiel permitted to cry, to mourn? Yes or no? Can you think of another story in the Bible when someone lost his son and the father could not cry? What is his name? What is his name? Come on, you should know this name. You must know this name because that is the desire of all nations. When God, the Son Jesus, died, God, the Father, could not cry. I want you to know who hung on the cross, who is the desire of our eyes. Now God had to make a decision. Do I spare my son or do I spare my people? If he cried for his one and only beloved son, he could have cried, but none of us here would have been saved. But God chose not to cry. Fathers, can you imagine losing your only son and you not crying? Hardening of the heart. This morning, God wants to give you a new beginning, a regenesis. Let's go to the cross. In my anger and my wrath, God could have spared his only son. My God, why have you forsaken? This is the father hearing his son grieving. Daddy, daddy. Oh. He crushed his son. Ezekiel not mourning is a foreshadowing of what was going to take place at the cross. If we have to be saved, we have to be grieved, my friends. But that day, the representative was Jesus. Do you know who would the temple be destroyed by? By the heathens. Just as God kept quiet, people, when they saw Jerusalem broken, when they saw the temple being destroyed by fire, do you think they cried or they did not cry? Tell me yes or no. They did not cry. Do you know why? Why? When there is too much of grief, you can't cry. Who do you cry to? Everybody has lost at least 3-4 members in the family. I was pastoring a church in my place in India. There was another church nearby. There was vacation Bible school, and the church took about 150 children. They went in their ship, and the boat was capsized. All the children died. All 150 children, small children, went for vacation Bible school. There was so much of pandemonium and panic. Who will cry to whom? I heard, I lost my only son. And I heard another woman say, I lost my only daughter. Another man said, I lost all 5 children of mine. And I could see they just couldn't cry. That's what happened. This morning, if you are continuing to live in sin, there will come a point in your life where you will not cry or grieve. Don't harden your heart in sin. My friends, the people back in Jerusalem, their lack of mourning won't be because of self-discipline, in obedience to God's command. It's because they had the opportunity to repent, to have a new beginning, but they refused to have a new regenesis. That takes us to the end. I'm going to take another maximum 7 to 8 minutes. Let's go to Ezekiel 24:24. And ye shall do as I have done. Ye shall not cover your lips. Children of Israel, When you see Nebuchadnezzar, when you see Babylonian army, when you see the military coming inside and they destroy the wall, burn the city, bring down the entire thing, and the desire of your eyes are gone, what do? Don't cover your lips. If you have lost your children, don't cry. Many parents are losing your children spiritually. You better cry right now. Be on your knees and cry. It is better to cry now and bring repentance than to see him unrepentant and you not cry. The desire of your eyes needs to be Jesus. That takes us to another level. What does he say? And your tears shall be upon your heads and shoes upon your feet. Ye shall not mourn nor weep, but ye shall pine away for your iniquities. All what matters in your life is that this morning I don't worry or don't care about anything about anybody in your life. Have your sins been covered by the blood of the Lamb? Have you really repented of your sins? Do you feel sorry? Don't be stiff-necked. Don't be stiff-hearted. Don't be hardened in your heart. That takes us to another one. I like this. Ezekiel is a sign. According to all that he hath done, shall he do. And when this cometh, ye shall know that I am the Lord God. Ezekiel is only prophesying now. His wife is dead. His wife is going to be buried. But before the burial service, the greatest divine service message that is preached is, do you see my wife dead? And do you see me not mourning or crying? This is a sign. This morning I want you to see Ezekiel. Not at Ezekiel's sermon and preaching. I want you to look at Ezekiel. He is a sign. What is that sign? He's a sign of God. And he says, exactly in a short time, you will see Jerusalem destroyed. Do you know, friends? Right after this prophecy, Ezekiel became, can someone complete it? Ezekiel, after he prophesied this prophecy, he became dumb. Ezekiel lost his speech. Do you know for how long? Anybody knows the Bible? That gives me another 8 more minutes to preach. It's very simple. There was a man who escaped from Jerusalem when the city was destroyed, when the wall was brought down. You heard Elisha read for us this morning, Ezekiel 33, 21, 22, right? A man escaped all the way from Jerusalem and he came all the way to Babylon and said, hey, friends, relatives, do you know what happened in our country? What happened to the city? Do you know what happened to the temple? He said, tell what happened. The temple, the desire of our eyes is destroyed. Immediately, do you know what happened to Ezekiel? Also, thou son of man, shall it not be in the day when I take from their strength, the joy of their glory, the desire, and they set their minds upon their sons and their daughters, that he escapeth in that day shall come unto thee to cause thee to hear it with thine own ears. Ezekiel, you prophesy and you keep quiet. You became dumb. Ezekiel never prophesied for several months. He was a dumb prophet. A dumb prophet preaching the soundest message. In that day shall thy mouth be opened to him which is escaped, and thou shalt speak. In other words, Ezekiel never got to speak until the day he met the guy who came all the way and carried the tummy. And then God says, you will be dumb no more. Lord, why do you do all this? You are a sign. 2 times you find the word sign. And they shall know that I am the Lord. We are going to continue this afternoon at 2:30. Don't miss it. We are going to continue here for 2.5 hours of this morning. We fasted. Last night we fasted.
As we are going to break the fast just now in a short while, I want to tell you humbly, people of God, God is God. And He wants to be the desire of your eyes. Even if it is the temple, don't put your desire on the temple. Don't put the desire on any human being. A human being will let you down. Your own spouse will hurt you. Your own boss will put you down. I want you to be encouraged to look only at Jesus. I'm going to give all of you 2 minutes to close your eyes, bow your head. God loves you, and He tells you, I love you, but you have not made me the desire of your eyes, and I want to be the desire of your eyes. Will you please close your eyes, bow your heads with me for 2 minutes, everybody confessing their sins. I'm going to close with a real story. This is a true story that happened. There was a man, and he had a very peculiar job. And his job was to be the operator of a certain bridge. This was so fantastic a job assigned to him. And every time he would see the train come, he has to press the button and the bridge would collapse. And when the train was gone, he would press it again and the bridge would go up. But he had one son. And he wanted to show his only son that bridge. A true story. And so as this bridge master took his one and only son, he showed him how the railroad looked and how the bridge looked and how it would collapse. But his son, his only son, he loved the trains and he always loved to watch the trains. But as he was going, he said, son, I will take you in a train. The son was so excited because he loved the train. Children, we all love trains, right? I want you to listen to this true story. And as he was going in the train, he came across many passengers of different categories. I'm going to show you the many groups that are represented in the train here. This is the young child that was carried by the dad. As he went into the train, many in the train were lonely. How many of you are lonely? How many of you are lonely? God loves you. There are many people who are upset. And of course, there is always a group of people who are selfish, who just want to enjoy life, nothing else. We have these people. There are many people who are suppressed, oppressed, deeply hurting. And there are many of us who struggle with habits that we don't want even our best friends to know, secret sins. And what happened? One day, as he took his son there and he showed him the bridge, one day the driver did not see the red signal and the bridge was still open. It wasn't closed. And then the little child over there said, Dad, Dad, the train is coming. You are not seeing the bridge. It is still open. Dad. And he tried his level best to get the attention of the dad.
You know what the dad did? Daddy, but the dad wouldn't listen. Now he had only one option. His dad had told him a small little trick, how to pull a small lever, a red lever a little bit. If only he can pull that, the bridge would collapse. So when he went there, the little child went and pulled the lever, but as he was trying to pull the lever, he just slipped inside. Now, the train was just inching towards the bridge. The father had only one option. Just leave the bridge open and allow all the passengers to die, or pull the trigger and crush his son so that his son will be dead, but everyone in the train will be saved. If you were the father, what would you have opted? He pulled the lever and the son was crushed under the train. And everyone in the train never knew what happened, but they were just enjoying. But for the people to live, the son had to die. For you and me to live in this world, someone had to be crushed. And his name is Jesus. Let us come to the cross and repent. Amen.